Hallelujah. While you remain standing, we're going to bring Dr. Costa to the podium tonight. What a tremendous job and what a tremendous blessing he has been. Many of you missed our business meeting. I don't know all the reasons why, but we had the shortest business meeting we've ever had. We had a great report. Praise God. And if you need to know or would like to know how much that was increased in your giving and your tithing, tremendous year. God really has blessed his people, and he's going to continue to bless. 2018 is going to be just a better year, a greater year, and we're looking forward to all that God's going to do. God's going to bless people. God's going to bring people in.
Amen.
In 2018. You can say that prophecy, or you can say that as my opinion, but we'll see what happens in 2018. God's a good God.
It's true.
Hallelujah. God's an awesome God. We're going to bring Dr. Costa right now.
Yes, sir.
You give him your undivided attention, and you will be blessed.
Amen. Bring that word. Bring that word. You know what I'm saying?
Let's give the Lord Jesus a hand for each other. It says, now at what time you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither,
the lyre, the harp, the pipe, and all kinds of music, if you be ready to fall down and worship the image I made, very good. But if you do not worship it, you will be thrown immediately into a blazing furnace. Then what God will be able to rescue you from my hand? Of course, I read in the NIV and you were reading in the King James Version, but it says substantially the same thing. What God will be able to deliver you from my hand? With the help of the Lord, I want to preach to you for a short time tonight on this subject, coming through the fire. Coming through the fire. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you, mighty God. We thank you, Lord, for your saints that are gathered here tonight. We thank you for your anointed word. We thank you for the word that we've received already this week. We thank you, Lord, for the word that we're about to receive. Lord, multiply it in our life and bless us right now in the exalted name of Jesus. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. The Bible talks about those who, because of adversity, simply gave up. Because of the strain of a circumstance or situation, their faith gave out and they simply gave up short of their reward. And I want you to know that the purpose of the fire is to get you to give up. The Bible says that Satan has fiery darts. The Bible says that you will go through fiery trials. And the purpose of the fire, it would seem, is to get you to give up. If it is the enemy that controls the fire. The king in this case, King Nebuchadnezzar, is looking for the most gifted, talented young people to be raised in his palace. And I believe that the enemy of our soul is looking for young people tonight. He is not looking for, forgive the expression, but he's not looking for the losers. He's not looking for those that are distressed, but he is looking for young, gifted, talented, attractive, apostolic young people. Can someone say amen?
Amen.
The Bible says that the king is going to feed them a diet. It is going to be his diet. It is going to be the meat from his table. And we know from other passages of scripture that meat represents doctrine. God said in the book of Malachi, he said, bring ye the tithes into the storehouse. Why? We know that the tithes are for the priests. What did the priests do? They instruct us in doctrine.
Yes, sir.
That there may be meat in my house. We know in the New Testament that teaching and doctrine is described as strong meat. So the enemy, excuse me, the enemy wants them to eat the meat from off of his table. And that is not all. But he wants them to drink the wine. Wine represents the Spirit.
Yep.
Because in the New Testament, the Holy Spirit is referred to as new wine. So the king is saying, I'm going to put my thoughts in their head. And I'm going to put my spirit in them. Mm-hmm. The enemy is going after the most gifted to corrupt them.
Yes.
And they check on them every 10 days. But the three Hebrew children, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, said, let us do it our way.
Yes.
Let us not eat the king's meat or the king's wine. Let us eat food that we prepare, food that we gather. And the Bible says when they check in on them, that their countenance is brighter. I want to say to someone today, don't be defiled by the doctrine of our age. Don't be defiled by the spirit of our age. God
says every road leads to God. And it doesn't matter who you worship. As long as you're a person of faith, you're going to go to heaven. If you listen to some people, everybody's going to heaven except Hitler. Amen.
Right.
And maybe some mass murderer. But I want you to know, don't be defiled by the doctrine of the day, the prevailing thought of the day, or the spirit of our day. The king is troubled by dreams, and he says, I want someone to interpret my dream. And his wise men and his soothsayers come to him, and they say, you tell us your dream, O king, and we will tell you the interpretation. And the king says, well, that's easy. Anybody could do that. And then how do I know if the interpretation is right? So I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm not going to tell you the dream. I'm going to let you tell me the dream and the interpretation. And if you can't tell me the dream, I'm going to kill you. And if you do tell me the dream, I'm going to reward you. He has a dream, but no interpretation. And all the ones that have been eating meat from his table and have his spirit are not able to discern the dream that Nebuchadnezzar has. But there's another Hebrew man in this region, in Babylon, and his name is Daniel. And Daniel is able to understand visions and dreams, because in Daniel 2:21, he set himself aside unto God. The Bible says that Daniel was of the opinion that God raises up, deposes kings, and raises up others. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to the discerning. And so the question that Daniel answers, the king's dream, and the king is impressed. But the king says, listen, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to set up an image of myself. I'm going to gather the musicians from throughout Babylon. And I'm going to cause my people to bow down and worship the image that I have set up. And this shouldn't be a problem, because I've already indoctrinated them. My spirit is already in them. But there were three boys who were not infected with the spirit of that age.
Yes, sir.
There were three boys that were not infected with the doctrine of that day. And so when everybody else bowed down, they did not bow down. And so Nebuchadnezzar said, I don't think you heard what I told you to do. I want you to bow or you're going to burn. And they said, he said, I'm going to give you another chance. And they said, we don't need another chance, O king.
Right.
And we heard you the first time.
Right.
But our answer is this. We're not going to bow, and the God that we serve is not going to let us burn.
Right.
And if he does, we're still not going to worship your image. And so the king said, all right, I'll tell you what. I'm going to heat the furnace hotter. I'm going to make the fire hotter by 7 times. And then he asked the question, and when I heat it 7 times hotter, who is the God that's going to be able to deliver you out of my hands? Now, my brothers and sisters, I'm not going to belabor the point tonight, because you know the story, and I don't intend to keep you very long, but I want to point just a few things out about this story. Had the devil controlled the fire, then it would have heated it 6 times hotter. But the enemy didn't even realize that the God who was able to deliver them out of his hands was in control of the situation. Because there is sometimes that a fire comes to you and it is from the enemy. But there are other times that God allows you to go through the fire, but he controls the fire. Consuming fire. Can someone Besides that, I'd rather burn for God than bow for the devil any day. Did somebody say amen?
Amen!
So I want you to watch the story. Nebuchadnezzar has no idea what's going on. So he gets the strongest men in the kingdom, and they bind up the three Hebrew boys, and they begin to carry them towards the fire. But as they get close to the fire that is in a pit that they have dug, the fire is so hot, it does not burn the three Hebrew children. It burns and kills the mighty men that were carrying them bound before they ever get to the fire. Now my question to you is, if the three Hebrew children were being carried bound to a fire, and the ones that had bound them and the ones that carried them had already fallen dead, then why didn't the three Hebrew children just try to run away? But the Bible says that they fell into the fire. That's an unfortunate interpretation, because my study shows that it's more likely that they jumped into the fire. They were afraid of the fire when they realized that it was God who was in control and not the enemy. Can someone say amen? The God that we serve is acquainted with fire. He appeared to Moses as a burning bush. In the New Testament, he said his cloven tongues like as a fire to represent his spirit. The Bible, I already told you, says our God is a consuming fire. Jesus's eyes are like a flame of fire in Revelation chapter 1. When you get in the fire, your unseen help becomes seen. It becomes visible. What is helping you is not obvious until you're in the fire and you are succeeding when you should be failing. You are living when you should be dying, and everybody around you knows it, and they see you victorious in spite of the fire. What is helping you that used to be invisible becomes visible? Can someone say amen? The king looks into the fire and he says, didn't we throw three in? But I see four, and the fourth looks like the Son of God. And they see them walking around the fire. My brothers and sisters, when you're in a fire, don't stop. Don't lay down. Don't sit down. Don't stay stationary. Keep on walking. They see them walking through the fire, and here's the thing. They were loose from their bonds. They were bound when they threw them in, but they were loose now. The only thing that the fire that God says is meant to burn is what is binding you. I came for a word with a word for somebody tonight. When God is in the fire, the only thing that burns is what binds you. You might have gone in bound, but you're going to come out blessed. You're going to be amazed when you think that God is all you've got, and then realize that God is all you ever needed. Can someone say amen? It's the pressure that defines who you are. You identify a lot of things in the fire. The pressure of the fire defines your character, defines who you are. The pressure of the fire identifies your friends. If they start in the fire with you, they're going to come out on the other side with you. But if they didn't start with you, they're probably not going to end with you. The fire had no power over them. Now watch this. The Bible says their hair, not a hair on their head, was singed. Watch this. You ought to know this better than anybody, apostolic. church. In the Bible, hair is symbolic of strength and glory. And not one strand of their strength or their glory was singed. Their coats were not changed. Coats in the Bible represent a mantle or a spirit that you carry. You can get a garment of praise for a spirit of heaviness. Joseph had a coat of many colors. Their anointing, their mantle was not changed by the fire. They came out with the same excellent spirit. Can someone say amen to that? Now some people go through the fire, but you can tell their hair is all burnt up. In verse 29,
the word God,
the king says, no one can speak against Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's God, because there is no other God that can deliver like this. Now, what was his question in verse 15? He said, what God will be able to deliver you from my hand? But because of the fire and because of the way they came through the fire, he answers his own question. And he says, there's no other God that can deliver like this. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego's God is God. You want to convince people that God is God? They're watching how you go through the fire. Can someone say amen? The fire did one more thing. In verse 30, the Bible says that the king, Nebuchadnezzar, promoted them, and they became leaders of Babylon. It was the fire that qualified them for promotion. But what happened to Nebuchadnezzar? Nebuchadnezzar never went through the fire. Nebuchadnezzar had the wrong spirit and the wrong attitude, even though he recognized God's power. And the Bible says that one day he forgot about the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And he said, look at what I've done. And look at what I've built. And look at how great I am. And God struck him. And he went out of his mind. And he ran through the fields of Babylon for 7 years. And when he comes to his senses at the end of his life, he said, I'd rather be in the fire with God than in a palace and be a wicked king. I want you to know it's how you come through the fire that shapes your testimony. It's how you come through the fire that is your witness about the greatness of your God. But my God is able to deliver you from every circumstance, every situation where your glory won't be singed and your anointing won't be changed. Your spirit won't be altered if you come through the fire with the right attitude and with the praise. Why don't you stand to your feet right now and begin to give God a praise in this house. I said give God a praise in this house. Give God a praise in this house. I want the musicians and singers to come. Hallelujah. Give God a praise in this house. Give God a praise in this house. Singers come. Musicians come. I don't care what you sing, what you play. Just make it victorious. Amen. Amen. My brothers and sisters, listen to me. God is doing things that you can't imagine.
That's right.
The problem is, if you listen to the news, you're going to get a very different picture of the fire that you face. You're going to get a distorted image if you drink the king's wine and receive his spirit. And you eat the king's meat and receive his doctrine. I'm not talking about anybody in particular. I'm talking about a spirit of the age that we live in. You see, because God is trying to bring us from victory to victory. But there is an enemy that's trying to get you to focus on